In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Yesterday, we consecrated a new bishop for the Diocese of Virginia, and it was a glorious time. And for many of us who were there, and for those who watched, I think it was symbolic of a gathering of the community of the faithful. Now, it wasn't all the faithful, that's why it's symbolic. It was the community of the Diocese of Virginia, represented by clergy and lay people and all sorts of folks that ascribe to following the ways of Jesus. And this Advent season always brings us this time of how do we begin to order ourselves to think about our life in that place where we are the people of God. And the second Sunday of Advent every year is dedicated to the prophets. You heard it in the collect. We now have our New Testament prophet, John the Baptist. We'll say more about that in just a moment. And we have the Old Testament prophet, Isaiah. Now, I will tell you, if you were an advertising executive or a marketing person, you probably wouldn't lead with John the Baptist. I'm just saying. He came out to the wilderness in camel's hair. He probably smelled like a camel. He ate locusts and wild honey. And then he began shouting at people. And he began to shout not at the people who lived on the margins, the peasants or this sort of thing. He shouted at the people in the middle of the structure of Jerusalem. He shouted at the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And I'm sure he earned a lot of brownie points by calling them a brood of vipers. Yeah. Way to go, John. Now, it may have been true, but he's not going to win friends and influence enemies. And then he, in the midst of all of this, refers to the prophet Isaiah. So I think we need to look at the prophet Isaiah for just a moment. And I'm going to take a side and parenthetical moment to tell you that when fancy seminary professors and religious professors at our major universities look at the book of Isaiah now, they see at least three authors. They give them fancy names. There's Isaiah, there's Deutero-Isaiah, and there's Tritero-Isaiah. Get it? Okay. Remember, they call the Q document of the New Testament, which is a theoretical document. Q means quella, which means document. They're so inventive in the academic environment. But in this, they break down. And there are, in my mind, three sections of the work of the book of Isaiah. And whether it was just three authors or one author or a school of authors, it's sort of irrelevant. It begins to tell the story, inspired by the Holy Spirit, of what God is doing with his people in a time of great distress in the middle of the 8th century BC. During a time of weakness for anybody in that area of the world, there were no major powers who had asserted their control over what we call Palestine now. It was in between an ascendant Egypt and an ascendant Assyria. That's when the nation of Israel was formed. And in this time of Isaiah, Assyria is on the rise. Yes, that whole area of the world has spent most of history being fought over. We haven't fixed it yet. And Isaiah wanted the people of Israel, or God wanted the people of Israel to know a certain thing, and he spoke through the prophet Isaiah. And I think this particular speech, and he spends a lot of time in this section of Isaiah, is a wonderful speech. And so it starts in chapter 40 with verse 1, and you've already sung the first verse. Comfort, O comfort, my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. And then it continues. A voice cries out in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, every mountain and hill be made low, and the uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." There's a promise in these words that behind the brood of viper thing that John has just said to the Pharisees and the Sadducees, this promise that the Lord, God, the God of Israel, whose dress is number one Mount Zion place, where the temple is, will be the source of their salvation and their restoration and their comfort. And he will fix all of these things. He's told them in this chapter that is being referred to by John that whatever disorientation they have suffered will be fixed by God himself. And then they use this wonderful phrase, "Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed." Now I'm going to tell you, in Jesus' time, the glory of the Lord had a special significance because it was that sense of that part of God which expressed all sorts of fabulous and wonderful things. Not his justice, not his mercy, but his glory, his doxa. And when Paul comes along later on, he recognizes Jesus as God's glory. That was Paul's great insight into all of this. And if you really want to know the truth from this particular piece, I don't think any faithful Jew in the middle of the 8th century was thinking of Jesus. But they were thinking of the God of Israel, who would be present to the people of Israel, just like he had been present to them when he created them in the wilderness. The pillar of fire by night and the pillar of cloud by day. He could dwell with his people. That's what the temple was all about. These were people called out to do something. And here's what they were called to do. And I am now going to go to an earlier bit. And this is the bit we have from the readings this morning. "A shoot shall come out from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord." Well, when Paul and Peter and the apostles were reading this later on, they said, "Oh, I know what Isaiah was talking about. He was talking about Jesus." I don't know that when this was said that people would have made that claim, but okay. And then this is what it says: "The wolf shall lie down with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion and the fatling together. A little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze. Their young shall lie down together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp. And the weaned child shall put its hand on the adder's den. They will not destroy on my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea." That's the glory of the Lord, to restore all of creation to what God intended it to be in the book of Genesis. You know, the early chapters before Adam and Eve get to work. What God wanted for his people to do was beating the leading edge of the people who understood how God wanted the world to be, a world of justice and righteousness, a world where the poor were in the same level as the rich, that they were sharing and opening their hearts to generosity so that nobody would miss the goodness of God. This is the vision that is in Isaiah. 750 years or so before Jesus comes around. Oh yeah, it's up there too. Thank you, Patrick. So when we get to John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness, this is all in his memory and his life. He's been marinated in the stories of Israel. He knows what God is looking for. And Israel is hungry for a prophet. Now, yes, John could be offensive, and you probably wouldn't invite him to dinner in your house. I probably wouldn't either. But he was magnetic, and the people heard his voice and were drawn to him. And this is what he tells the people: repent. Now, I know, as we listen to repent today, we think, feel guilty. No, nor should you feel shame. Maybe a little guilt, but not shame. What repentance was for John was amend your ways. Just do things differently. If you're a brood of vipers, you have a way out. Yes, there's the baptism, which is the metaphorical and sacramental blessing of them, although they would never have used the word sacrament back then. You are washed of your sins and you are making a public statement about how you will change your life. He is asking the people to fulfill their mission from God. And it's important that John was able to be fiery so that the people would wake up and hear, be alert. And that, yes, there was probably going to be some winnowing and some other things going on, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. So if you're asking me as an Episcopal priest, is this real or is this metaphorical? Yes. But I wonder what transformation feels like when we're trying to get rid of all the stuff that keeps us from fulfilling this love mission of God. To let go of it can be really hard and sometimes may feel like we're burning. And yes, maybe he is clearing the threshing floor, but is his intention to clear it for the purposes of getting rid of stuff? Or for fulfilling stuff? I think this is a God who is looking to bring his people out of the threshing floor to be the fruit that he grew them to be. The speakers to the people around them of what God looks like, what true community in God looks like. And that's what we practice here. We do it weekly. We come together. We sing glorious songs. We pray wonderful prayers. But it's a training ground to be formed into that relationship with God that looks like the relationship that John is talking about. I am, of course, not John, so you don't hear me calling anybody a brood of vipers. I'm sort of a squish, and I think what I would say is, I'm in the wooing business, and I would like you to understand that, yes, God loves you. It was interesting. Yes, yesterday we got the whole bit from Michael Curry, and he kept threatening to keep his sermon short. He didn't. In fact, at one point he called his threat a metaphor. Yes. Short for Michael Curry doesn't mean what short means for the rest of us. And short wasn't what that service was. You could have watched a pro football game inside that service. So if you want to watch it on streaming later, I advise you to make sure you have built-in bathroom breaks and some coffee or something else. But it is glorious. And I do, as I look at those metaphors, those moments when we try to do glory, it's an important encouragement to us all that the glory God wishes for us is the glory of the peaceable kingdom. And that when we rehearse it like that in liturgy and as a community representative and true at one time, that we begin to see that vision of life working together. That's also my prayer for Advent. This is a time to walk through salvation history. We started with judgment. We're given the words of the prophet to show us the way out. Next week, we'll get John the Baptist. He gets 2 weeks because he was pretty important, but he doesn't have any other time. And then we get the working out plan with a young woman in Bethlehem and her husband and a baby. Let me encourage you. We have prayers and collects for you to use during this time. Light your Advent candles. Go listen to carols. Do anything you can to remember who you belong to. The love that this God pours out for us. And his wonderful words. Comfort, comfort ye my people. The Nicene Creed is found on page 358. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace, we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God. especially the Anglican Communion.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Justin, Michael, Mark, Susan, and Isaac, bishops, and for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in His church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. For the Holy Church of God, the Anglican Communion, the Episcopal Church, the Diocese of Virginia, the Diocese of Ezo, St. John's Church, and Smith Chapel United Methodist Church. For the nations and people of Afghanistan, Egypt, Ethiopia, Iran, Russia, Saudi Arabia, Somalia, South Sudan, the Tigrayan rebels of Ethiopia, Uganda, and Ukraine. For those who have been commended to St. Francis for prayer, Daryl, Bruce, Joan, Philip, Mary and Dan, Vicky, Harlan, and Lois, Rachel, Bill, Nancy, Michael, and Aaron, Dirk, Kathy, and Tim, Clarence, Lucy, Janet, Steve, and Karen, Cindy, Rick, Martha, Kathy, and Steve, and Laura. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever. Never.
We pray for all who have died, especially Sarah Durden, niece of Clara Sue and Clarence Ashley, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them,
who put their trust in you. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone, and so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
It's great to see all of you, and it's wonderful to have such a good crowd come out on a Sunday morning. It is Advent, but great to have all of that. Are there any birthdays or anniversaries for which we should pray, or people who are having them for whom we should pray? Okay. All right. Oh my goodness. Lots of early December folks. Dylan, if you would stand right here. So we have Dylan and Jessica and Tamber. My Rolodex works in my brain. It's sometimes just a little slow to catch up. So we're going to do a birthday prayer for these wonderful people. I will representatively. Diana Lucy's birthday is today, so we'll add her into the prayers. O God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servants, Tamber, Jessica, Dylan, and Diana, as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their lives through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Many happy returns of the day. Many happy returns of the day. Happy birthday to you. Okay. We're going to prepare the table for communion. We have some instructions in the order of service. I hope they are clear. Carol and Jessica are going to help me with chalices, correct? Thank you very much. And they will be posted here and there. And your ushers will direct you. Thank you, Bill. It's good to have you both. Stephen, yep, see, it works. It just is slow. I had the little pinwheel going. Anyway, so with that, we will have the choir give you something to meditate upon while we prepare the table to receive you.
Rejoice in the Lord, all the way, and again I say, rejoice.
We continue the service with a great thanksgiving for Eucharistic Prayer B. I invite the congregation to stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Because you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us heirs in him of everlasting life, that when he shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil, and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with blessed Francis and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer, Redeemer of the world, give us your peace. The gifts of God, for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. I invite the people to stand for the post-communion prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Sun of Righteousness shine upon you and scatter the darkness from before your path, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Our final hymn is number 65. Lord.